Our scripture reading this morning is taken from Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 13. Genesis chapter 3. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die. You will certainly not die," the serpent said to the woman. "For God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. Then the man and his wife heard the sound of Yahweh the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God said to the man, "Where are you?" He answered, "I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid." And God said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree that I commanded you not to eat from?" The man said, "The woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree, and I ate it." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent deceived me, and I ate." The grass withers and the flowers fall, but the word of our God truly stands forever. Amen.
Am I on? Oh, hey, there it is. Will you pray with me? Lord, as we open your word, as we hear from you today, we're reminded that it's you that does the work, that it's not about any one person or about the words that I've prepared, Lord, but ultimately it's about what you want for us, what you have for us today. And so, Father, we pray that you would speak, that the words of my mouth would be your words, and the meditations of our hearts as we reflect on this scripture passage would be your thoughts in us. Holy Spirit, we pray that you would do a great work in us, a new work, that you would accomplish in us what you intend for us to hear today, that we may be strengthened, that we may be equipped, that we may be renewed, and that we may be sent out to bring the good news of your Son, Jesus, to everyone whom we will encounter this week. Lord, we give this time to you for Jesus' sake. Amen. So as we turn to Scripture this morning, we read a very familiar passage, the passage of the fall. To give you the context, the first two chapters of Genesis, we get this idyllic garden scene after God has created everything by his word from nothing. We see Adam and Eve, the first man and woman, living in the garden, and they are living essentially with God, in the presence of God. This is the place where God interacts with them, Right? God isn't randomly walking in the garden in Genesis 3. We get the sense that this is a thing that happens often, and that because of their perfection, because of their innocence, because they have not sinned yet, that they have a direct and very intimate relationship with God until something goes wrong. And that something that goes wrong is sin. They disobey God. Forever then disconnected in relationship from him, separated from him, because God is truly holy. And he can't be in the presence of sin. But it's from this point, too, that our stories begin to evolve, because we are born into this sin. We, like everyone else, are in need of that Savior. And we see that, we if you just go through the whole story arc of the Bible, we see that in the person of Jesus Christ. He comes to earth, he lives that perfect life that Adam and Eve were supposed to live. He dies for our sins on the cross. He's risen from the dead, confirming who he is and confirming what he has done, that he is the Son of God, that he is the perfect sacrifice, and that our sins are forgiven through him. And from that point on, Jesus sends out the believers, his apostles, and then the church in his name to tell others about him, about his love, about what he has done, and show them, disciple them, in how they too can find this salvation in Jesus Christ. And that is what we call evangelism. Now, if you've been with us for any length of time, you know that we've been talking about our vision, and we've been talking about things like prayer. How do we enact our vision, bringing the good news of Jesus Christ to every household in the Hopkins community? How do we enact that through expectant prayer? And how do we enact that through radical obedience to the Holy Spirit? And these are things that we have discussed about turning to God first, about seeking his heart first, about our hearts turning towards him, and us living our lives out of who we are created to be in him. And now we've been talking about evangelism, which is just a big churchy word for sharing our faith, sharing the love of Jesus, sharing the gospel with other people. And we get hung up on that a lot, because if I tell you that you need to live out your faith, and we talk about, you know, things like following the Ten Commandments and having good morals and following what Jesus teaches, nobody really gets to, well, we get hung up on that. We fail to do it. But we no one really cringes if I say, hey, right, the Bible says you should do some things and you shouldn't do some other things. And for the most part, we're like, okay, yeah, I can get on board with that. But when I say then that, or when we look at the Bible and we see that the Bible says, also, you should go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, we go, whoa, whoa, whoa. Easy does it, right? Let's just back the train up a little bit. I'm not really sure that I can do that. I'm not really sure that we get hung up. We feel like we're not good enough. We feel like we don't have the equipping or whatever it is that we need to effectively go and share what we believe with other people who don't necessarily agree with us or may not necessarily believe it. And so what we've been talking about, particularly in the last 4 weeks, is equipping ourselves, equipping the church, Hopkins Community Church, for effective evangelism. Each week in your bulletin, you've had some questions that have been written down, and those questions have been sort of directives to say, hey, these are ways that you can practice this. I didn't bring my golf bag out today, but remember we had the golf bag analogy where I have this really nice golf bag and it looks really cool, but I'm really terrible at golf. You wouldn't know it until I started golfing. And then you would know, right? So the idea being that if I were to actually practice golfing, then maybe I would get better. Golf is like one of the only sports where you can practice and do a lot of practicing and not ever get better. So the analogy starts to fail at that point in time. But the reality of practicing something, practicing a craft, learning how to use the tools in your toolbox, practicing an instrument, whatever it is, as you practice, as you do these things, you will become more adept at them. You'll become more comfortable with them. You'll become more proficient at them. And that's what we've been doing over the last several weeks, these questions in the bulletin. You can find that bulletin online too. Questions that kind of prompt you to try a few of these things. Now, I also want to remind you that we've been talking, we've also tried to navigate around the sort of preconceived notion of what evangelism is. When we think of evangelism, we think of having to go and essentially it's the ground and pound mentality. I don't want to offend anybody, but when you get that knock on the door and there's the guy in the suit, right? You know what I'm talking about. We kind of get that idea. They come there and they have their pamphlets and they have their things to give you, and you know exactly what they're going to say. You know exactly what they're going to ask, and they're there to push this thing on you. And we get this idea that that's what evangelism is. And it's not. It's so not. I mean, it can be. At some point in time, we are going to want to share our faith. We are actually going to want to share Jesus, who he is, what he's done. But what we're talking about is doing that in the context of relationships, building relationships with the people around us, and then inviting conversations. Not where we have all of the answers and we say, you need to do this right now. Inviting conversations and inviting interactions around the lives of people so that they become engaged in a process that God is working on in their hearts that opens them up to hearing the message of the gospel through our lives and through our words. And so we've been talking about noticing, the art of noticing, right? Our eyes are open. We're actually looking around. We're not so busy and engaged in our own lives that we just don't engage with the people around us. We look up and notice those people around us. Notice things about them. Notice what God is doing. Praying, the art of praying, that we are engaged not just outwardly this way, but that we are engaged this way as well. That we are, our hearts are being aligned with God's hearts. And that the way that that happens is through prayer, that we seek to hear from him about what is going on around us, about what is going on inside of us, which is often the bigger barrier to effective evangelism. The art of listening. As we engage people, we don't do so just with an agenda to get an answer that we want, but we listen to people, listen to their stories, hear about where they're at, why they're there, what God is doing. And so far, you haven't had to say a thing. Right? We're 3 weeks in, three topics in, and we haven't actually had to say anything. The first 3 weeks is really about aligning our hearts and our lives with what God has called us to do, which is to be about other people, to take on the heart of the Father for the people around us, which means stepping aside from ourselves, from our agenda, from our tasks, and everything that we have going on in our lives, and actually having a heart for others. And we see this time and time and time again in Jesus' life and in his ministry. He's going somewhere and something happens where he stops. And when he stops, whatever stops him or whoever stops him takes his full attention. He's not halfway like, all right, I got 1 minute for you and then I gotta go, right? Jesus is there. He's 100% there. And when he's 100% there, we see things happen in his name and in through his power. And that's exactly what we are called to do too. You know, we walk around. I left my phone over there. We walk around and we have our phone in one hand and we're talking to people in the other hand, and you're there and you're there and you're there and you're there. We're never fully present anymore. And that's really what the first 3 weeks are about, being fully present where we are. And today we make a shift because we're taking what we've learned about being present and about aligning our hearts with God and then starting to actually put it into action, starting to actually move with it in some way, shape, or form. And that is why we are looking at the art of asking questions. Notice again, right? So now we're 4 weeks with four topics in, and none of them has been hit your neighbor over the head with the Bible until they believe in Jesus, right? And none of them have said, you have to have all the right answers and you have to fully articulate everything perfectly about your faith, otherwise don't do this. None of that has been said. What's been said is we align our hearts with God, which means that our hearts are going to be for other people. And now we're going to engage, but we're not going to engage people by just bringing a message and hoping that something happens. We're going to engage them on a personal, relational basis. Remember all the way back at the beginning of this, so it was several weeks ago now, but we read a scripture from 2 Corinthians 5. 2 Corinthians 5:16 says, from now on, we no longer regard anyone from a worldly point of view. Right? We've aligned our hearts and our lives with God so that the way we see the people around us, these aren't just people. They're not just beings that are walking around. These are people that God loves, people that God is calling out to, people that God desires to bring to him. And so as we've done this, as we've aligned our hearts, right? The scripture says we do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others more above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but to the interests of others, right? He says in our relationships with each other, have the same mindset as Jesus Christ. That means that we're quick to listen, slow to speak. It means that we are noticing and giving our attention fully to others. It means that we are committed to a life of prayer where we are aligned with God. Right? That we're not in it for ourselves at this point in time. I think that's one of the most frustrating things. I don't want to rag on like the folks that come to the door, right? Every couple of Saturdays we have friends over. They come unannounced. They stay for a few minutes and then they leave. But one of the most frustrating things about it is that they come with this idea of relational engagement, but you know that they're just driving their agenda. Because it doesn't matter how you answer their questions, you're still going to get a pamphlet. And it's going to be the same pamphlet they intended to give you before they walked up to the door, right? We're not in it for ourselves. We're in it for the other person. Yes, we want them to know Jesus. Yes, we want to be able to share a faith with them eventually. Yes, we want them to experience the grace of God and eternal salvation. But we want to do it through a way that invites them in rather than beats them over the head with it. And we said from the very beginning of this vision conversation too, we're going to do this thing that God has called us to do as Hopkins Community Church. We are going to go and bring the good news of Jesus Christ to every household in the Hopkins community. And if not a single one of them comes to our church, right? They go to other churches, they find other faith communities and stuff like that. We will still call it a win because people are coming to Jesus. It's not about building numbers for ourselves, right? It's not about building up this church. It's about building up his church. It's not about building our little kingdom. It's about building God's kingdom, right? That's the way it's supposed to be. And this is modeled by the Father and the Son. Interestingly, you go back to Genesis 3, right? All of what happens, right? They're living in this idyllic thing. Satan comes, he deceives the woman, and then and she eats, and the man eats. She gives it to the man, he eats, right? Sin enters the world. Everything is broken. And the omniscient God, the one who knows everything about everyone, the one who has created all things, he is walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And what is the first thing that he does? He asks a question. Adam, where are you? Every commentary I read this week that says the exact same thing about this verse. It's a rhetorical question, right? God didn't need to ask this question. He knew exactly where Adam was. He's behind that bush over there on the left, right? And he knows exactly why Adam's hiding over behind that bush on the left, because Adam has sinned and because he's afraid. He's hiding from God because he's naked, because he's ashamed, because he has lost that connection. God knows what's going on, but God asks anyways. Have you ever been in a situation where you're sharing with someone and then they just ask a good question, a question that you know is just simply a curiosity relational question? It's a question where they are moving towards you. They are stepping into whatever emotions are going on. It's a question that you know they're asking because they care. This is the question that God asks. God could have left them. He could have literally come up at verse 15, right? Verse 14, he says to the serpent right off the bat, he says, because you've done that. He doesn't ask a question to Satan. He doesn't care about what Satan has to say about this whole thing and why Satan did this. He says, because you've done this, But he doesn't do that to Adam and Eve. He asks a question. He actually asks them a whole series of questions. Where are you? Who told you that you were naked? What happened? Eve, what happened here? What led to this? And through the course of some conversation, they are able to interact with a God who loves them and who's heartbroken about what has actually taken place. The art of asking questions, of taking a step into someone else's situation, someone else's life, and experiencing with them, exploring with them what is going on. It's how we learn. It's how we grow. It's what Jesus models as well. If you were to turn over, if you have a Bible open, you turn over to Luke 10. Luke 10, verse 25, right? It says this. On one occasion, an expert in the law, so somebody that knows everything about the law, or at least as much as he could possibly know, stood up to test Jesus. Hey, Jesus, the Son of God, the one who knows everything that's going on here. So he knows what's going on. He knows the person's heart and all that. Says, teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Now, this expert in the law is probably a Pharisee. He's probably one of those guys that's trying to trap Jesus all the time. He has his own agenda. He's trying to prove that Jesus isn't the person he says he is, or whatever is going on. And Jesus knows this, right? We're told all throughout Scripture, when Jesus is asked a question or when Jesus is put on the spot, he knows people's hearts. He's the Son of God, after all. So Jesus has every right to be like, nah, we're not going there, right? I'm not going to play this game with you again. Stop. But instead, what does he do? He asks the guy a question. He goes, what is written in the law? How do you read it? Have we ever had a moment where somebody's talking about something in Scripture, and instead of just giving them a blanket answer or kind of brushing them off because we're nervous, we say, well, let's open the Bible together. Let's find that Scripture passage a second. Let's read it together and see what happens. Right? So the teacher of the law says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. And Jesus says, yeah, you're right. That's correct. Do this and you will live. But the guy wants to justify himself, verse 29. And so he says, well, who is my neighbor? And then as Jesus is asked for something, he tells this parable, right? The parable of the Good Samaritan. Guy goes down from Jericho, he gets beat up, a couple of people leave him by the road, and then the Samaritan comes and helps him out. And then he asks at the end of the thing, he gives the guy an answer, but then instead of interpreting it for him saying, this is what you do, he goes, which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? He asks another question. He engages and lets the teacher of the law, answer, but he's also opening up space for the Spirit's work on this guy's heart. As he's heard Jesus' words, he's giving the guy, the expert in the law, space to interpret and space to listen to the Spirit, space to experience what God is doing, space to experience maybe conviction and what he's trying to do there. Mark 8 is another example. Mark 8, verse 27, if you turn over there, Jesus and his disciples went on to the villages around Caesarea Philippi. On the way, he asked them, who do people say that I am? He asks a question. And Jesus, the Son of God, the one who created the universe, right? He's walking with the disciples, and he could be like, hey, y'all, you know I'm the Son of God, right? Let's just make sure that we get this clear. You need to know who I am. We'll get the power structure. You know, everybody understands what's going on here, right? He doesn't say that. He asks the question, who do people say that I am? And they answer, you know, John the Baptist, da, 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 da. And then he asks another question. Who do you say that I am? Who do you say that I am? He gives them an opportunity to declare it for themselves, to think through what they have seen and what they have experienced thus far, and then discover it for themselves. The reality for us is that we are called to follow and to model the same example, the same actions, the same heart as Christ. Jesus doesn't always ask questions, not always, but he does oftentimes, especially for the people that he knows disagree with him, the Pharisees. You know, when they try to ask him a question, he asks them a question back. When they won't answer, he doesn't answer. It's kind of funny. But the reality is that Jesus' heart is one of inviting people into a conversation and into a relationship. That's why we say it's not about religion, it's about relationship. Jesus invites us in. He wants us to discover for ourselves what is going on. He wants us to help us down those lines so that when we come to faith in Jesus Christ, when others come to faith in Jesus Christ, they will claim it for themselves instead of being told what they have to think. That's what belief is. It's what coming to faith is. It's when we come to it and then own it for ourselves. It's why going to church with your parents doesn't save you. Right? There's a point at which you have to take it in. You have to own it for yourselves. And we are called to open those doors as Christ's ambassadors to those in our lives as well. Colossians 4 verse 5 says this, "Be wise in the way you act towards outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversations always be full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone." And perhaps we can read that verse to say, maybe the answer isn't us with all of the right knowledge coming at people with information. But maybe the right answer is actually asking questions and moving towards them, stepping into our own discomfort perhaps. Because it is uncomfortable. I mean, it's uncomfortable for me. The heart of discerning acquires knowledge. For the ears of the wise seek it out. Remember last week we talked about a story of a missionary who spent time listening. Well, part of that listening was then asking questions, gaining information and knowledge so that when the time was right, the conversation about who Jesus is could happen. Asking good questions engages people in conversation. It draws them into relationship. It allows them to discover things for themselves. I have a coach, a pastoral coach. I meet with him once a month, and his job, what I pay him to do, is to ask me questions. Literally, if you wanted to boil his job down to brass tacks, he listens to what I have to say. We reflect on the last month. We reflect on things that are coming, and he never tells me, "This is what you should do, John." He often asks me the question, "What do you think you should do, John?" And then through the course of conversation, we talk and we think about things together. And at the end of the day, he usually doesn't say much. Of an hour-long phone call, he usually talks for about 10 minutes because he's just asking questions. And that relationship has been so invaluable to me. It's helped to shape who I am as a pastor, as a father, as a husband, as a person, as a Jesus follower. Because he's inviting me to discover. He's inviting me to evaluate. He's inviting me to come into this relationship. Jesus models this, and we are called to model Jesus. But it isn't his propensity to ask questions that we need to model. It's the heart of Jesus for others that drove him to ask questions, even to the Pharisees. Right? Even to the people you see on Facebook who you know are going to disagree with you and they're just going to be jerks and you don't even want to talk to them, so you just don't even, you avoid them like the plague, right? You've unfriended them at this point in time. But the heart of God isn't one that pushes people away. The heart of God is one that gracefully welcomes people in. That doesn't get upset and angry to start yelling or whatever. It's not one that just blocks people because they disagree with us. If you want to think about a time in our lives where people disagree vehemently about things that seem kind of ridiculous, we kind of are there, or at least we kind of were there. And we get all up in arms about just things instead of, here, I'll just put it out there. We get all up in arms about things like masks and things like vaccines and things like all of the stuff that we're being presented with right now. And I have my own opinions on it too. But what if instead of just saying what we think and blocking the people in our lives who don't think the way we do, we'd actually engage in conversation with them about why they feel the way they feel. That we welcome the dialogue in such a way that actually moves us closer to the people that disagree with us than pushes them away. What if in our lives when we have disagreement, this is the reality. It's a reality for if you're married, if you're dating, if you have siblings, if you're human, right? Whatever it is, that there are times in our lives, sometimes it's every day, where we are interacting with people who disagree with us or we're upset about something. What if instead, this is just in our relationships within our inner circle, instead of saying the things under our breath, of turning our back and walking away, we actually stepped into a little bit. Why is it that you're upset? Why is it that, and actually invite those relationships in? If we can practice those things with the people that are closest to us, we'll become more confident in doing them later on. We are called to model the heart of Jesus, one of love and compassion. This is different than asking questions because we have an agenda. Right? Asking questions because we have an agenda means that we care most about our stuff and what we have on our mind. Engaging people in conversation, asking questions, stepping into their lives without an agenda, just because we care, just because we're curious, means that we care about them and we've actually set ourselves aside. And this is what God does. This is what God does with Adam and Eve at the very beginning. Right? God could be like, you screwed it up, get out of here, I'll take care of this later. But instead, as we just sang, a song that is a part of my own testimony, you see the depths of my heart and you love me the same. Right? What an amazing God. The one who steps out of eternity and into humanity to make possible our relationship with him once again. The one who turns graves into gardens. The one who turns ashes into beauty. Who turns shame into glory. That is the crux of what happens even in Genesis 3. Right? The moment or later that day, whenever it was in the scheme of how days worked, right? How the day works, whenever, right? I don't know if it was early morning and they were hungry for breakfast or whatever. But in the cool of the evening, God steps forward. And we already see his grace as he reaches down to them and says, where are you? Where are you? Brothers and sisters, this is the same love, same compassion, same mercy that brings Jesus to the cross. And that calls us to bring ourselves into other people's lives so that God, who is rich in mercy, who desperately loves every single person, can say again to them, where are you? I'm looking for you. I want you back. In some ways, this is exactly what the table is about as well. We have no right to come to the Lord's table on our own. This is his table. It's not ours. We don't get to set the rules. We don't get to talk about who comes and who goes. God has already done that. And the reality, right, if you read the parable of the rich man that throws the banquet. He invites all of the people who are worthy to be there. All of the good people, all of the wealthy and the rich, all of that rich guy's friends. And he invites them, and at the end of the day, what happens? They're like, oh, sorry, I gotta go buy a cow, or you know, do the farming or whatever. They have all these excuses for why. So the rich man says, then go and find everyone else. I don't care what they look like. I don't care what they smell like. I don't care how they're dressed. I don't care if they have money. I don't care if they're laying in the gutter drunk. I don't care. Bring them. Because I want my banquet to be full. That's the image that we get at the table. God says, I want you. And you know what? I want that person and that person, that guy over there. I want all of them. I want everybody down the street, down that street, down every street in Hopkins. I want them. So go get them and bring them to the banquet. Bring them to the feast. Because I don't want a single chair left empty. That's what Jesus is saying to his disciples as well. The image that we get of the Lord's Supper, that God came down, was broken and bled for us and for them, so that we might be saved. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. He gave it to his disciples. He said, take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. In the same manner, he took the cup and poured it out. He said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for the sins of all people. As often as you eat it, as often as you drink it, remember me. And I think there's more to it than that. Because he reminds us, when we think of Jesus, we are also reminded of who we are as a redeemed people called to be Christ's ambassadors. He wants to bring more people to his table, and he's calling us to be a part of that. So we're going to do communion a little different. I don't know if you noticed this, but we're outside. It's a little warm. It's a lot of warm. The way that we're going to do communion today is through intinction style. What that means is you're going to take a piece of bread, you're going to rip it, and you're going to dip it into the juice, and then you're going to eat it. Now, for that, there are going to be four stations, one over here and over here, and then in the back as well, one over there and one over there. And then if you're in the car, somebody will come to you as well. And we're going to have just a time. There'll be some music playing. You can kind of reflect on whatever it is that God's doing in your heart and in your mind right now. Maybe take some time to engage. If you're feeling convicted about something, engage that conviction. Bring it to God. Lay it at his feet. When you're ready, you can go to whatever station in the four corners there and take communion. There'll be an elder, an deacon in these places. If you are in a place right now where you are still uncomfortable with that idea, that's okay. We have little cups. They're little single-serving cups that have a wafer in them, and they have some juice in them. Actually, Kyle, I'm gonna call on you because I told you weren't going to do anything, and now you are. Kyle is going to come over. He's going to grab those little cups, and he'll just be standing kind of out front. And if you aren't feeling comfortable, go into one of these stations. Just raise your hand. If you can't get up, just raise your hand, and he'll come to you, and he'll bring you one of those cups so that you can join in communion. And lastly, the rules. The rules are God's rules. And he says this, if you believe in Jesus Christ as your Savior, you are welcome here. Doesn't matter if you've been going to this church all your life, if you've been going to church all your life, or if you came to Christ 10 minutes ago, it doesn't matter. What matters is that you believe. You can be 5, you can be 50, doesn't matter. If you believe in Jesus, you are welcome at his table. I'm going to invite the elders and the deacons that are that I've talked to. You guys come forward. One other thing too, in the front here, on the front on either side, there will be gluten-free bread as well. So,
overwhelmed by the weight of your sin, Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling.
The gifts of God are for the people of God, symbols of the grace that he gives us. Come, for all things are ready.